So, Lord, we just thank you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, I'm happy that everybody's here. Sometimes I don't like to stop praying. It's a tough shift for me. And I hope that every one of you can enjoy that kind of relationship with the Lord. And somebody says, well, I really want that. Well, then just do it. Then just practice it. The most important thing that you want to do is to have a personal relationship with the Lord. It's not a struggle for me to have a personal relationship with my wife for many reasons. And, you know, just to be around her is not a struggle. It's not a heartache. It's not a hardship. And it's even far greater with the Holy Spirit. The beautiful thing is the Lord went away and he sent to us the Holy Ghost. Now, understand when, obviously, you know, the Lord says, I'll be with you and in you. The Holy Ghost will be with you and in you. Lo, I am with you even unto the end of the world. So when you have the Holy Spirit, you have Jesus too. We know he's come to dwell on the inside of us by the Spirit which he's given unto us, 1 John 3:23. And so it's a package. But the bottom line of it is the Holy Spirit, he is God resident right now. Jesus resident at the right hand of the Father right now. God the Holy Spirit is here resident with us. And I want to talk tonight about the gifts of the Spirit. In the context of the school of the Spirit, there are many things to consider. Tonight I want to talk about the gifts of the Spirit. There's a couple of things here now. Number one, you've got to believe that Father has purposed for you to have the gifts of the Spirit. Because if you don't believe that, you can't even get started here. Okay? And then you got to believe that ardently. You got to believe that passionately to the point that you covet it. It's not time for you to covet the boat, you know, the 32-footer, you know, Bayliner that's going down the road that's getting ready to go out tuna fishing. It's not time for you see that. You observe that. You know the function of it. You know how great it is to be out there, you know, with a 50-foot blue whale going underneath the boat kind of stuff, the thrill of it all. You know, it's not time for you to covet that. It's time for you to be able to see other things that are, I'm going to start off with just as real, but actually more real because it's lasting. It's forever lasting, okay? That's forever lasting. Forever lasting, okay? Those things that are temporal, well, you know, they're going to cause a whole lot of problems for you. The reality of it is we want to be able to see. We want to be seers. We want to be able to see. The Word of God gives the ability to see. We want to be seers. We want to be those who are constantly receiving revelation from heaven. Listen, there are some basic spiritual laws to walk in, and you can have this. It's a continual flow. It's not just every once in a while. And that's really why we do the School of Spirit. The School of Spirit 101 and their School of the Spirit where, you know, people are closer to me. The Lord show me, you know, they've got certain things. Not closer to me in the sense that, you know, I love them more or anything. They're just closer to me in a sense of proximity. And they've got things established and they're ready to go to the next place. If things aren't established, principles aren't laid out in your life, you can't move on. As much as you want, you can't graduate, you know. It's based on relationship. It's not based upon getting all the answers right. It's based upon a relationship and observing a spiritual law. So number one, you got to believe that Father wants you to have these gifts, okay? And you got to believe that they're available, this is what Father wants for you, because that's huge. Now, because let me just say this. If you're like trying to talk Father into having it, you probably won't ever get it. Because that's not the realm of faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So you're trying to talk God in. You're not sure that he wants you to have these. That's why it's important for you to be certain that Father wants you to have these spiritual gifts, that he's put these spiritual gifts in the church. And so that's why that's number one. You know, it's his idea. And now you're excited about it. Number two, that they are available to you, not to everybody else. You can't look at yourself as being problematic in the body of Christ. Hey, you know, the one that God doesn't really favor or like, you know, the outsider, you know, the least preferred child, okay? Behold Leah. You know, the Lord has come to say, behold Leah. where's the one I bargained for? No, he loves us. He loves us dearly. It's a great sermon, behold Leah. But anyway, you know, and I want to talk to you about functioning all nine gifts of the Spirit. And I've got this book here, and it's The Unlimited Authority of God. And it's really funny to me that people would begin to question the works and greater works if you gave them this book, because the crusade was these works and greater works. In Nepal right now, there is a group recognized by the government, reports to the government, and it is the Confederation of the Alliance of Churches. The Lord gave me the word of knowledge. I had an open vision. The Lord gave me word of knowledge. And I said, the government will recognize the churches of Nepal as an ally and not a foe. Happened within 2 months. That day, the Alliance of Churches was formed, the nation of Nepal. That's why when we go into Nepal, it's no problem to get all the churches together. Okay? Because they're an alliance. And they most of the leaders were in this first meeting we did in 2006. There's a picture of it in this book. And the picture of it, it's actually towards the back of the book. And it's a picture of me standing here on the pulpit here, right here. And there's another one. It's even a better one. It's my wife and I with our hands up in the background. I'm pretty sure that picture's in this book. It's right in the front. This picture right here. I was standing there worshiping the Lord. This is when I received an open vision. Right there, this picture. I don't say that in this book. I'm just putting the pictures. I don't tell you what happened in the pictures. I'm having an open vision. Did I ask for an open vision? No. I'm just doing what I'm supposed to be doing. 34 years ago when I started ministry, I always had people tell me, oh, you know, where's God at? Where are the proofs of the anointing? What all we got to do to get in to the signs, wonders, and miracles? And it was almost like always this heaviness, this doubt, always people just kind of, you know, kind of kicking the can down the road. It ain't ever going to happen. For me, I was sold out on it. And because I was sold out on the miracles of God, signs and wonders, the supernatural, it was never something that was a doubt thing going on in me, you know. It was, this is what's going on. And so out of that, I grew and I developed and I just stayed with it. And that's really what we got to understand here, folks. We're growing. God's word is settled. You're not settled. God's word is settled. Now, if I can get fixed on His word and settle out on His word, I'm going to have everything His word says if I will not weary in well-doing. If I'll give myself to these things, I give myself to the Spirit, things of the Spirit all the time. There's people that used to be in this church that, you know, are preaching and ministering elsewhere, and they became faint, and they went off on a tangent. Now, I mean, I don't even know if they even believe in the gifts of the Spirit anymore. They speak in tongues, and that's about it. God may heal. Who knows? Man, I'm going to tell you right now, if you believe, have a concept in your mind that God may heal you, who knows, you're not going to get healed. Because that's not faith. Faith is sold out on what God said. It's giving yourself. If you've got a room, an open door to doubt, doubt's going to work. I mean, Father wants to give us a knowing, you know, an absolutely knowing. This woman right here, you probably can't see it, but they're carrying her in. This is one of the women that they carried in on a big sheet because they didn't have anything else to carry her in on. If you watch on the web, you watch the video on the web of the crusade in 2008, there's a very thin, frail woman walking around in a red dress. She hadn't walked for years. That's the woman that's being carried in right there. Now, what happened is we had a tent set up for the infirmed, and what happened was I'm just going quickly. I'm walking by, going, getting ready to go on the pulpit, and there's this compulsion. It just grabs me. It's like a tractor beam. It just grabs you. You want to do something else. You can't do it. And then I walked past all these people, and there's this woman. I said, today's your day of healing. Get up. Is it? Now, I walked past a lot of people. What's going on? What's going on is I'm being led by the Holy Ghost. He knows she's got faith, okay? And He knows I'm going to walk past. The other people got pain, too. She hasn't walked for a long time. She hasn't eaten. She's been an invalid. She's wasting away. Her legs are just thin. Her arms are thin. She's emaciated. Huh? But God knows. I walked into a house the other day, and, you know, because it becomes very just natural. It becomes just natural. It's just, you know. I walked in the house the other day, and some people's house, and I looked at the woman in the house, and her eyes were all puffy and extremely bloodshot. And I said, it's the wood that you're burning in your house. It's your smoke, the smoke in the house. And they didn't know that I was giving them a word of knowledge. They just thought I was guessing. I'm going to guess that they thought I was guessing because it took them a long time to shut the thing off. And, you know, but that's just the way it is. You just know. You have a knowledge. And it just comes out. You don't have to say, hey, I got a word of knowledge right now, man. You know. Thus saith the Lord. I mean, because if you do all that, that's mental, man. And it isn't supposed to even work that way. This is supposed to be an overflow. This is supposed to just be natural. And then the other day, it wasn't too long ago, I was back by these with these people, and the woman said, you know what? You came into the house and you said that the inflammation in my eyes and the red eyes was because of the smoke. She said, we stopped burning the wood. I imagine they couldn't believe it because they've been burning wood. You know, so what do you, you know, how is this different? And we stopped burning the wood, and as soon as the wood stopped burning, the inflammation went away from my eyes, the redness of the eyes. So the Lord didn't tell me to pray for her. I did lay my hands on her. But the Lord just told me, it's the wood that you're burning. If they would have just turned the stuff to go, turn the wood off. Oh, you don't turn the wood off. Don't put the wood in. It's just stop. We have a hard time hearing the word of the Lord because we're mental. We're always thinking, well, we've been burning wood and that never caused a problem. Well, if they then when they retrace their steps, they discovered, ooh, we're burning a wood that we never burned before. Okay? So what I want to, the reason I'm giving these examples is I want you to just understand how natural it is. You're going to have to relax. You're going to relax. People are just so tense. Give me a word. Oh, God, use me. Oh, why can't I function in the gifts of the Spirit? Exactly. That's why you can't function in the gifts of the Spirit, because you're asking why. Because that's a realm of doubt and unbelief. You just need to be sold out with the relationship with the Lord, just loving Him. Huh? Father just works all this. He grows us up. He matures us. Because we stay in faith, and we grow in faith, and we increase in faith. And so, you know, I really, you know, when I did this booklet, I actually did it for the leadership of Nepal and for the meetings we had late 2011. And I put these pictures in it. One reason is because the person who was raised up by T.L. Osborne took the book and had no pictures in it, and he did this and he threw it down. And I said, what are you doing, man? He said, well, that's exactly what T.L. did to me when I first did a book. He said, there's no pictures, and he threw it away. And then he went and put some pictures in it, and T.L. sat down and read the book. And so, I mean, it was just, it was to impress upon me I needed to put pictures in it. And then later on I go, you know what, that's right. I do need to put pictures in it because this is all about faith. It's about an unlimited authority of God. And it's just not a dry lab, okay? This is in the context of all nine gifts of the Spirit at work. It's in the context of dreams and vision. I call up a guy I didn't know in Nepal, 2006. Parliament had just given, the king had just given his authority over to Parliament. I called this guy up. I said, hey, the Lord wants me to come to Nepal. He said, who are you? I said, my name is Mark. He said, well, who are you? I said, I'm my name is Mark. I'm a pastor in San Diego. And the Lord told me to come to Nepal. I didn't know this guy. Okay? God supernaturally, by a number of steps, did this. Okay, and what was I doing when the Lord initiated this? I was out cleaning the horse pens, and the Lord said, "You're going to Nepal." Okay, we're not in a prayer meeting. We're not fasting. We're just doing. We're walking out a life with God. People are going to have to walk out a life with God and quit being so stressed out about everything. Quit trying to make it happen. God makes it happen. Hallelujah. We just got to be convinced that He wants us to have these things, huh? And that they're available, and we give ourselves in that realm. We just shut off every form of doubt and unbelief. That's how we live. And then a series of events happen. I get this guy's telephone number through a miracle event, through a guy who was led to come to my house, that never comes to my house, then gives me this telephone number. I call this guy. I didn't say, so-and-so gave me your telephone number. You know, we've been having signs and wonders and miracles in the church. You know, we just recently had a baby who received it. So I didn't go through all this. I just said, my name is Mark. I'm coming to the ball. And it was really dry, and it was dead and boring, kind of like that, because it was early in the morning, and I'm calling him because I want to catch him. He's like, what are you going to do when you get here? I said, well, we're going to do signs, wonders, and miracles. He said, well, how many people you think you can get together? Nepal's a tough nation. I said, I'll come for one. And that was about the end of the conversation. The next day he calls me up and he goes, who are you? Why? That night the Lord gave him a dream. The Lord visited him in a dream. Everything happened here. God can do his stuff. I want it to be the way the Lord does. I want Father to connect the dots. I don't want to do no networking. I don't want to do something that I can create. Who are you? I'll tell you, I'm Mark. I'm here in San Diego. He said, well, I had this dream. You're supposed to come to Nepal. And then he starts telling me some stuff. I'm not going to tell you because it would be too wild. It's too self-serving. Anyways, it blows me away what God told him. But nonetheless, you know, so that's how it all happened. There's a dream. We get there. There's signs, wonders, miracles. People are coming. Demons are going out of people. People are mentally insane. The folks know they're mentally insane. This mentally insane person is now standing on the platform with their face shining with radiant presence. I mean, shining. Their face was shining. Dress, clothes, and in their right mind. Just all these kinds of things happening. Okay? The dead had not been raised to life in that meeting up to that point, 2006, to that I know of. You know, but devils had gone out. The crippled had walked. Blind had seen. Deaf had heard. Jesus did it. Jesus did it. He just did it. It's what he does. He says, I'm with you and in you. God's with me and in me. And I know what God does. That's the God factor. Ha, hallelujah. And all I got to do is not get in his way. All I got to do is step out of the way. And, you know, if you're a controlling person, you don't know how to step out of the way and let God, the Holy Ghost, do it. You've got to be in control of everything. If you're not a controlling person, you know how to step out of the way. Let God, the Holy Ghost, take control. And so then we had a vision. Vision, I said, and then I prophesied. I said, church will come into, out of the vision. I just declared what I saw. I gave a word of knowledge, not really prophecy, word of knowledge, declaring what I seen in the vision, standing there looking at a vision. And I said that the government will recognize the church as outline, not a foe. There will be a formation of the alliance of churches and recognized by parliament. And 40-year war will come to an end. 2 months, both happened. So I walk into Nepal. Now what are they going to do? There's the man who prophesied. Church and alliance. We'll have an alliance for him. And that the 40-year war will come to an end. And so what does the Lord do with that? He opens all these doors. I could spend the rest of my life in that region and running wide open. But that isn't what the Lord has me to do. You got to know when to start and you got to know when to stop. Hallelujah. Sometimes it's hard for people to get both. I think sometimes the hardest thing for people to get is to know when to stop. Hallelujah. I'm just saying, look, if the Lord could use me, he can use anyone. And I mean that with all of my heart. There is no respect of persons with God. If he's done anything through anyone, you know he will, then it's available to you. And Jesus really emphasized that. Everything I'm doing, you're going to do too. Anything that God has ever done through anybody, he'll do through you. I mean, T.L., for example, T.L. was sitting in one of William Branham's meetings and watching William Branham flow and function in the word of knowledge, telling people, you know, hey, you're about to die of terminal cancer of the stomach. Get up right now. You're healed. Hey, you there, that guy right there, paraplegic. This is how it happened. You're in an automobile accident. Get up right now because you're completely healed. And T.L. Osborne turned to Daisy and said, we can do that. You see, if he can do it, we can do it. You just got to do it. People, because I think what happens is people get so in, especially, I don't know why, it just, why it happens, especially it seems it happens to Christians. They get into a mentality of just a failure mode. It's just a failure mode, just like a condemnation mode. And I can't do it. You know, mode. And you need to be, you know, God wants to give us great confidence and wants to give us great boldness. Those are fruits of the Spirit, by the way. They are not, although they are not listed in Galatians chapter 5, they have fruits of the Spirit. You know, I've named 26 fruits of the Spirit. There's more than 9 gifts of the Spirit, but we just kind of encapsulate them there, you know, because it's just, you know, 9 gifts of the Spirit that's named in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and it's good for you to grab that. You'll hear me almost every time I go to prayer. You know what you're going to hear me say? Guess what you're going to hear me say? Father, I thank you for the word of knowledge. I thank you for the word of wisdom. I thank you for the discerning of spirits. Thank you for the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, the gift of faith. I go a little slower than this, but I thank you, Lord, for prophecy, for tongues, for interpretation of tongues, for dreams, for visions. Oh, Lord, I thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you, Lord. I thank you for the great operation manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Make it a part of your conversation. Start praising him for it. Start thanking, hallelujah, hallelujah. Start thanking him for it. And so, you know, if you haven't gotten into this book, the unlimited authority of God, the authority that God has given to the believer, now nothing is impossible. I want you to get into it. Just get into it. And don't be doubting about it. Just look at the pictures. Go online. Look at the video. To this day, if I look at the video, I get hit with the same anointing that was happening when I was there. How easy was it? Ann and I walked up onto the platform. I mean, they had been singing for, an hour and a half. A great group of musicians from a Pentecostal denomination. Wonderful minister leading a wonderful choir and music. Beautiful Holy Ghost anointed music. Nothing's happening. Everybody's quiet and peaceful. Ann and I walk out onto the platform. We didn't even get a translation yet. I just said, hello. And as soon as I did, people's demons started going out of people all over the place. It was literally pandemonium. It was demons going. People screaming, running, rolling on the ground, thrashing around. I mean, it was wild. Just with a hello. Somebody said it was the Holy Ghost hello. Yeah, he's with me and he's in me. Okay, I'm already convinced of that. Hallelujah. I wasn't fretting. I wasn't going, oh, God, please show up. Oh, God, please, oh, please. If you don't show up, it's going to be a total mess. It just never even was a thought. I had no fear in it. You would have had to go find me 20 years ago to find some fear. See, there's growth and maturity. Praise God for growth and maturity. You'd have had to find me some. You know, I had to fear 20 years. I'd be, oh God, please. If you don't show up, I'm gonna be in a mess. No, just relax. It's just, we're here. It's the God factor. You know, how do you begin, you know, when you think about this, how do you begin to thank God and recognize the miracle of God in you being here right now, in you having what you have right now, being allowed to do what you're allowed to do? You need to become exceeding joyful. I mean, over to even seemingly the smallest things, because if you can't see God in your midst right now, you're not going to see him in your midst later. It gets worse. It don't get better. You're going to have to start practicing having God in your life right now. You're going to have to be, you're going to have to practice being a benefactor. A beneficiary of a great benefactor. God is a wonderful benefactor. He's supplying all that we have need of right now according to his riches and glory. And that's far more than just money. Hallelujah. We're blessed with all spiritual blessings. Man, when you know that, when you believe that, how can you ever have a moment of complaint? Wait a minute, I'm blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. I may not see it. I may be too stupid. Okay, it's okay to call yourself stupid. You can't call anybody else stupid. Okay, I may be too ignorant, I may be too dim-witted, whatever, to be able to perceive at this juncture all that God is doing. All I need is a little bit more spiritual understanding, and then I can get all happy about God's word. Or I can go ahead and get all happy about God's word right now because I believe that his word is true, hallelujah, and that he's given an honest report concerning these things. And in so doing, now I'm just gonna, hallelujah. I'm just gonna do what God's called me to do. And I'm gonna be confident that I'm going to be confident that he's going to be right in the big midst of my life, providing everything that I have need of. That he's going to be right. That's a gift of faith. Do you know that? How big's your need right now? Now, let me just tell you about me for just a minute. 33 years ago, I'm in school. 30 years ago, I'm still in school. Okay? I don't receive an offering because I'm stupid. I'm preaching, pastoring, but I didn't receive an offering. Okay? Just mostly a bunch of students, and so all the finances that do come in, because people drop some finances off at the box at the door. Okay? Take care, basically, of the bills. Okay? I have no place to live. I'm living on the third floor of the science department, sleeping in the lecture room for the chemistry department, or in the gas chromatograph lab, and or underneath the desk in my office, and I'm eating once a day, because I don't know how to move in the Word. I don't know how to move in the Word. Are you hearing me? I'm happy. I'm blessed. God's using me. There was many different amazing miracles, miracles that last to this day, miracles that you can go find people that tell you. No, I had an incurable disease. Pastor Mark just said you're healed and it was done. Okay? But I didn't know how to have faith for finances. I mean, praise God for my wife. She kept me alive. She brought cookies. She brought cookies and she, of course, I told no one. I didn't even tell her. She had no idea that I ate one meal a day. That's all I had. Because she would have taken care of me, but I didn't share that kind of information. This is just, you know, I didn't have to live that way. We live deprived of a lot of things because we get things in our head that are wrong thinking. Praise God, and we got that. I got married, and immediately my head went. When I got married, you know what? I immediately shifted and started saying, "Wait a minute, we need provision around here." Because I was thinking about her. Me, I'm like, I'll be fine. But now I'm like, oh, we need provision. Well, I still didn't move over into the realm of faith for finances. My dad was a preacher poor mentality generation. If you had any extra, it went to the mission field. Okay, you've had those tennis shoes on for 2 years. That's fine. They could go another third. They can go a third year. There's no tops in them, man. It's just got a little patch where you can still hold together. Sandals. They're alternative to sandals. And they're still working, so the extra money's going to the mission field. I was raised that way. So I didn't really understand how to begin to move in the gift of faith for finances. I had a block. It was always there. I read the Word of God. But I had a mental block on these things. This is a big part of where we failed to move forward in the gifts of the Spirit, whether it's the gift of faith for finances or whether it's the interpretation of tongues. The other night, there's praise God, in the midst of the church, there is a miracle anointing in the midst of the church. There are offices in the midst of churches. Realize there's the office of apostle, prophet, teacher, working of miracles, gifts of healing in the church, as is written in the Word of God in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, there's also the office of tongue and interpretation of tongues. As we begin to get connected with the body of Christ as members in particular, because this is the way God demands it. Father demands it relationally. If you can't be relational, you're just stuck. You're never going to move forward in the gifts of the Spirit, because we make a right and proper connection in a relationship. First of all, that right and proper connection is made in relationship with the Lord Jesus, with the Holy Ghost, where he becomes a companion. You're never absent of him. You're never on your own. The Holy Ghost isn't around right now, so let's do whatever. You know, he's off. So he's with me, and he's in me. And that really brings a whole nother consciousness of life. It brings a God consciousness into my life. It brings a presence of God awareness. People need to practice the presence of the Lord. You need to practice his presence. And if it's nothing else, you just quote the verses of Scripture, read the words of the Lord that describes that he's with us and in us. Behold, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world. Go all through all the verses of Scripture of his manifest presence, the temple of the Holy Ghost, on and on. And then that begins to cause you to practice the presence of the Lord. That right relationship with the Lord, of interacting with him, of recognizing him, of saying, Lord, I want to be used by you. Lord, I want to grow and mature in the things that belong to heaven. All of that is essential. That is essential. It is a dialogue. It's a relationship. When that relationship is proper, then Father wants the relationships that are around us to be in order. And if they're not, we're not going to be connected with the head. And we're not going to grow up into Him. We're not going to grow up into all things into Him. Okay? And that's what God's called, that we may grow up into all things into Him who is the head. Right? There is a connectivity that has to happen in the midst of the church. If you feel isolated, if you feel unloved, if you feel unwanted, if you don't feel like you don't fit in, all that's demonic stuff. That's not Holy Ghost stuff. If you feel like that somehow people are picking on you, they don't appreciate you, none of that is God's stuff. Look, the Holy Spirit doesn't, we don't have a Bible that's describing to us, you know, how to go around and measure people's love for us. You'll know that they're, you'll know that you're walking, be loved by others as dear children of the Lord. No, the Lord isn't saying that. He's defined for us an amazing love. Father loves us so much, He spared no expense. That's what He did. He spared not His own Son. He spared no expense. He showed us a love that He wants us to participate with. So if when we were sinners, if when we were alienated, if we were enemies by wicked works, God would commend His love towards us in such a way, okay? That we may say, He who spared not His own Son, but offered Him up for the sins of us all. Now we got to make a shift. We got to have that as a living reality. He did this for me, right? He did that for me. A lot of people got this as a living reality. He did this for me. He died at Calvary for me. He rose again. Oh, thank you. But this other part, they're having a real struggle with. How much more shall He also give you freely all things? We're over here. Oh, thank you, thank you. We need to bring both of them together here, huh? Because they're both connected. This is mine. I don't have to perform. I don't have to prove anything. This is just that which He has established. I mean, you look at Satan, one of the primary things in the temptation of Jesus is he's just trying to get Jesus to prove something. Prove it. Prove it. Show him who you are. Prove it. I mean, you know, come on. Speak to the rocks. They become bread. Satan knows how it works. Just speak to the rock. My. Speak to the mountain. Just imagine. Imagine when all of a sudden you have been fully empowered by God. You have accepted that you have been fully empowered by God, because He has already fully empowered us. We just haven't accepted that. It really isn't about receiving from God. It's about yielding. We sing the songs, "Oh God, rid the heavens and come down." He's already here. We sing these songs like, "Oh God, let your river flow out of me." No, you let my river flow out of you. A proper faith way to sing the song is, "Lord, I'm going to let your river flow out of me." Because He's already given. It isn't about Him giving. He's freely given. It's already been provided. Hallelujah. It's about you and I just receiving. It's about us yielding to Him. We don't know how to yield. We don't know how to yield. We don't know how to yield. We feel estranged. Got to get out of that. You've got to know that Father wants you to have these things. Hallelujah. And that they're available to you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. There is a connectivity that you want. Somebody says, "Oh, I want that connectivity. What do I got to do? Come hang out?" No, just start loving everybody. Start throwing down the thoughts, casting down the thoughts that would make you feel like an outsider, that make you feel like somehow people don't love you, don't appreciate you, got something bad to say towards you. "I know so-and-so doesn't like me." How do you know that? Well, the look they gave me. Well, how do you know they gave you that look? How do you know they were even looking at you? Have you ever looked at someone, looked in someone's direction, but didn't even notice them because you all of a sudden got a text message that just scared you or concerned you, or all of a sudden you felt bad about something, and now you're giving somebody the evil eye? You don't even see them. There is a lot of problem right here. You know, I've devoted my life to studying the Word. And I've been blessed to have a great, great, God's best mentors in my life. God's best mentors. I mean, Dake, who was a great mentor. He was a great man of God. Not every preacher has done a Dake's annotated Bible and spent that much time with it. Great mentors in my life. And, you know, I'm 2 years out from completely translating the entire Bible, which is, you know, I'm really focused right now on making it read so easy, so smoothly, but with accuracy, you know. But in all the study and all the research and all the time that I've given to the Word of God, I've come to realize that the Lord's going to hold us responsible for one thing: how well we loved. And really, all of this dimension of faith and all this dimension of the gifts of the Spirit, it all becomes a living reality and at work and viable in the context of this love, this servitude love, this laying down your life love, this compassion love, the greatest expressions of the power of the living God that I've ever seen manifested in my life, the greatest miracles. I'm just broken. They're just such overwhelming compassion. Ann and I, if you look at the picture, Ann and I are standing there. We're just standing there. We're weeping. You know why we're weeping? Because it's 2006. We're weeping because this girl who was so completely crazy, out of her mind, if she was in America, she'd be in a straitjacket, just violently living her life, just throwing her arms everywhere. In fact, when I walked up and cast the devil out of her, I want you to imagine a girl standing about this tall. She's approximately 19 years old, maybe 20. And she takes off rolling on the ground, and she rolls 300 yards so quick that you can't even imagine. The crowd is having to run to go with her. And when she gets to that end, she rolls to the other end. And Ann and I are standing on the platform, and I look out and I see this crowd. I go, what on earth is that? They're running. And so I go over there, and here's this girl. And her just saliva all over her mouth. Just wild, crazy, scary to death look, you know. Exorcist 10 look, you know, just the worst. And I walked over to her and I said, in Jesus' name, be made whole. That's all I said. And she stopped. And the people are standing around her. I said, no, just leave her alone. She's fine. No more prayers needed. We went home. This girl was nasty and dirty, just filthy, torn clothing, you know. We went home to the hotel, got something to eat, took a little nap, came back for the evening meeting. That girl had gone and she had been cleaned up. She had had clothes put upon her. She had Believing for the Impossible t-shirt on. And she's standing on the platform. Her face is shining with the presence of the Lord. And she's standing up there speaking in the microphone, telling everybody out there in this crowd, and they're roaring because they know who this girl is. They're just screaming, just shouting, okay? And she's telling them her encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ. My goodness. So Ann and I are just like, wah! We just like, ah! We're just standing there crybabies. Oh, God, you're so amazing. This girl, this poor girl, ah! It was in that brokenness. It's in that just, Jesus, you're so amazing, that I have an open vision. By and large, I'm going to tell you right now, that is really for me and for most of the folks that I know that function and flow in the gifts of the Spirit, that's the way it is. It's a place of brokenness. It's a place of just being so overwhelmed with His presence, just so overwhelmed with this person. I'm not to say that it's just that's where it's got to be limited. It's just that's where the great things happen. I mean, I wasn't really overwhelmed with the Lord's presence when I'm there in the pen taking care of the horses. And it's what we call scoop and poop. Because somebody's got to do it, right? You got to clean the pen out. And the Lord says, you're going to Nepal. One of the first times the Lord spoke to me such a strong voice And I stood up, and when God speaks to you, bust out of your mouth. You don't even know what you're saying. It's just like when I was saying to this woman just recently, oh, it's the wood you're burning. Just bust right out of your mouth. You know, and you know it's true. You know it's absolutely true. I'm actually mopping the floors for my wife, one of the few rare opportunities that she gave me, server. And she's always getting to it before I can get to it. I'm not kidding you. She does it sooner than I would do it. So, I mean, very few people are believing that right now, but I'm mopping the floor, I'm scrubbing, and the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. I stood up and I prophesied of a world event. A world event that took place inside of 12 months. Was I asking the Lord for that? Yeah. But I was asking him just on the context of the scripture, covet to prophesy. Okay? What does it look like to covet or something? You want it, you go to him, but I'm a little bit jealous that anybody else is doing it, and I'm not doing it too. Huh? That's covet. You can do that. I'm jealous. If I see somebody flowing in the Holy Ghost, man, I am on them. I'm locked in on them. I'm going, I want that. If you want it in the right way, you get it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Connectivity with the gifts of the Spirit within the body of Christ is absolutely essential. Being around the word of knowledge, being around the word of wisdom, valuing it, appreciating it. If you're dealing with, like, if you're in this thing of, I don't really think they got healed, you're not getting nothing. You over in a demonic, you're still hearing more the voice of the demonic. You're still more impacted by the demonic than the realms of the Holy Ghost. Right there. The good news is once you recognize it, you get to grow. You get to shut that lying voice down. Huh? Oh, I doubt anybody's really getting healed. I doubt they really fell out under the Holy Ghost. That they were just doing that because they're afraid of Pastor Mark. And I mean, I know that sometimes when I go up and I look at somebody and say, how do you feel right now? Now how are you feeling? You know, that can be a little bit, it can take you back, especially under that anointing, because I know the force of the authority that's there. But people aren't lying. They're going, I don't feel the pain anymore. The pain is gone. I mean, how many of you in the past 2 weeks have had pain in your body come into the meeting and the pain go out? How many of you, as soon as you walked out the door, pain came back? Okay. There are people that happens to. As long as there, I got a pain-free zone. I got a pain-free zone where people walk up all the time. It happens to me all the time. And it's just the anointing. It's just because I gave myself to this for the past 33 years plus. And people come standing to me, and I say, what's wrong with them? They say, well, I got pain in my... No, you don't have any pain. You're in a pain-free zone. Okay, we're going to pray over this thing. Say, you're going to be healed. I got pain in my... I don't have pain. Well, I don't have pain anymore. And then they walk out, and the pain comes back to them. They didn't know how to stay in that realm. The same way with sickness, same way with a virus, same way with a disease. But guess what? Don't beat yourself up and say, I am just terrible. I must not be a child of God. Say, just begin to covet. Say, Lord, I know that you have these things for me. I want to understand how to walk in them. I recognize a transition. Step into the church, no pain. Step out of the church, pain. Step into the church, no pain. Step out of the church, pain. Lord, I want to understand how this functions. How do I take this atmosphere with me? How do I take this realm with me? You begin to ask Father. You begin to ask the Holy Ghost questions. The beautiful thing is he's going to answer. Moving in the gifts of the Spirit is a relationship. When the foundational things are laid in your life, when you're going, Lord, I want to learn how to walk in righteousness. I want to learn how to hate evil. I want to learn how to walk in perfect obedience. You're talking Papa's language. You're interacting with him in a foundation way. I mean, you think about Jesus totally emptied himself so that he could in every way become as man, as Adam, with the knowledge of good and evil. And now the only way that the knowledge of good and evil can be dealt with properly is that you learn to love righteousness and hate evil. So he learned to love righteousness and hate evil. And because he loved righteousness and hated evil, he learned these things. He learned obedience. I mean, that's a radical reality of Philippians chapter 3, that he emptied himself and took on himself the form of a servant. He humbled himself even unto death. Philippians chapter 2. Humbled himself even unto death, what we would call the kenosis, the emptying of Jesus, to show us how to do this. And we get into this language. This is a love language with the Lord. This is his language. Now we're set, now we're in it. We're in a place where he's talking to us. He's growing us up. He's maturing us. The one thing is, if you fall down, you bust your head spiritually on the coffee table. You just learn how to walk. You don't just say, I'm going to sit down for the rest of my life. I can't walk. I can't do it. It's too much pain. It's too much for me. And too many Christians do that kind of stuff to some degree. You get up and you start moving again. Huh? You get up, if you fall off the horse and it steps on you three places, you just get back up on the horse. And hang on next time. Don't let go. Whatever you do, don't fall off. Now you got it. Now Cade knows you don't fall off. What if I fall off? People say to me, what if I fall off? You don't fall off. You hang on. You got plenty of things. And let me show you all the stuff you can hang on to here, okay? So the Lord teaches us real simple stuff like that. He teaches us how to hang on. He teaches us how to rely upon him. He teaches us how to relax. He teaches us how to just flow with him. The Word of God jumpstarts this thing for me. I know exactly what Father wants me to do. And the Holy Spirit then establishes it in my life with revelation and makes it real. Okay? So guess what? I'm going to call for people to be prayed for sickness and disease. Are you with me? If I didn't call for people to be, you know how long I've been calling for people to be prayed for with sickness and disease? For more than 33 years. If I didn't do that, guess what? We would still be wondering if God heals today. We wouldn't be quite sure. I wouldn't have had the opportunity to just start learning to flow and relax and walk by people. I've had people stand in front of me. I've had no pain. I've had no moment without pain for 22 years. You're kidding me. Not a moment without pain. Well, you don't have pain now. Totally healed. Why? Because I participate with God. I just do it. Huh? How many people are standing there in front of me and say, I don't feel nothing. I still feel just as bad as I've ever felt. I've had those kinds of folks too. And you know what I tell those people? Come back to the meeting. Where there was a guy in Nepal. He's sitting in a wheelchair. I could tell he was an intellectual. You know, just had the intellectual look. He had the computer scientist look. There's a particular look that computer scientists have. You don't know whether they're staring at you, glaring at you, or looking through you, or past you. You don't know whether they're concentrating or daydreaming. It's just this one kind of look. But at any rate, I'm just kidding. At any rate, he's watching all these people get out of wheelchairs. And he looks at me. He's sitting down on the ground. He's looking at me so earnestly. And he's looking around all these people who are walking, who had wheelchairs or had crutches or was on a bed, and they're up walking around, running around. There's a line of them coming up to the platform. There's one up on the platform. And he's saying, how about me? Pray for me. I said, come back tomorrow night. And he looks at me like, you got to be kidding me. But that's what the Lord said to me, come back tomorrow night. The Lord has this timing. There's things that have got to be adjusted. People back in the day of when we had great revivals in the United States of America, they would run. Those meetings would run 12 weeks, 14 weeks, 16 weeks. That was just common. And many people would, the miracles and the signs and wonders and the healings would break out many times in the latter part of those meetings, into the third, fourth month of the meeting. And people just coming, sitting under the Word of God. Why? The Word of God brings faith. The Word of God brings faith so long as you're willing to respond to the Holy Ghost. Did you know that? Did you know that faith comes by the Word, but faith also comes by the Holy Ghost? How many of you knew that? It's fruit of the Spirit. Because Israel had the Word preached to them, but it was not mixed with faith in them that heard it, so thus it profited them nothing. You're listening to me? Word of God's going to profit you nothing if it's not mixed with faith. Faith is something that's supplied to us by the Holy Ghost, by the very presence of God. He makes it available. This is faith. It's this realm of faith. It's this realm of just... And somebody said, how do I increase in faith? You increase in relationship. This is a gift, the gift of the Spirit. It's so important to recognize the manifestation of the Spirit is the Holy Ghost through our lives now. The manifestation, I'm going to put it that way, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost through our lives is provided for every single person so that we may profit from it, okay? The Holy Ghost himself divides individually to each person according to his will. That is an active interaction of the Holy Spirit in our lives with us. They all begin to speak with other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. To begin to be faithful, that's the baptism of the Holy Spirit is first manifested with this gift. It's the entrance gift. It's the first gift. And, you know, King James translated it, it's the least gift. It's the easiest gift. I wouldn't translate it least. I would translate it first, easiest. The one that's just there. It's default for you. You know, now it's a miracle. Somebody said, oh, I wish I could have a miracle in my life. Is there a guru satala? I'm going to make it easy to pay you. I wish I could see the signs and wonders and miracles of God. Why isn't God using me more in the gifts of the Spirit? And I stop and say, hold on. You know what's coming out of your spirit right now? These are tongues of the Holy Ghost. These are tongues of God. These are tongues of fire. Did you know that that was a miracle? It's a miracle. Has a miracle now become common to you? Is it somehow familiarity bred contempt? Is it something that's just common and now it's ordinary and it's not sacred anymore and it's not precious anymore? It's not valuable. I was baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, driving down the road as a young man and just weeping for a 4 or 5 hour drive. And all it is just gets richer. It's just with me. It needs to be in. It's a teacher. God uses it as a teacher. God, the Holy Spirit, who is the teacher, uses it as a teaching gift to adjust things, to prepare our hearts and to prepare our mouth to receive things. That's why it always needs to be excelling. I gave myself to excelling. I gave myself to hearing the voice of the Lord. I want to hear you speak, Lord. Now, if I want to hear the Lord speak, I'm not need to hear the Lord speak if I'm going to move in prophecy, if I'm going to move in inspiration, because he's an inspirer. He gives inspiration. How many artists here? Everybody's an artist, raise your hand. How many of you can paint and draw without any inspiration? You feel like a dud. Can you paint and draw without any inspiration? He's like, no inspiration? No, you're not going to do it. Guess what? You're not going to flow in the gifts of the Spirit without inspiration either. It comes. It's an inspiration. It's a glorious. It's far greater than just art. Musicians who write songs as well. People who write poetry. It's an inspiration. You know, you woke, how many of you, you know, that are in those kinds of creative arts, you wake up in the morning and you just got it. You got it. There's something you're carrying it around. And until you go to the canvas or until you sit down at the piano or until you sit down with your instrument or until you sit down with your pen, it just, you know, you're waiting for that moment because you got something and boom, it's just the best thing you've ever done. That's why you wake up with things in the Holy Ghost. It's an inspiration. It's this creative, glorious realm that he just supercharges us with. Now what happens is as you mature, guess what happens? It comes with greater frequency. It's not like, yeah, I flowed in the gifts of the Holy Ghost last year. I had 3 words of knowledge this year. Huh? Are you tracking? How many prophecies? How many words of knowledge? How many people got healed? Are you tracking? Somebody said, I don't keep track. Well, you're not doing anything either. I would got to keep track if I were you. Well, are you coveting these things? Do you earnestly desire these things? Do you want these spiritual gifts? All of that is very, very important to the operation of them. Do you hunger and thirst after these things? Because it is the kingdom of God's expression. Do you understand that? The Lord Jesus said, if I work miracles among you and cast out devils by the Holy Ghost, then what? Then the kingdom of God has come to you. So he tells us to seek the kingdom of God. Really, when you begin to grab a hold of the kingdom of God, and I like to tell the story because it emphasizes it. I knew this before this happened, okay, because the Lord had emphasized it to me already. But I had the League of Churches in the nation of Egypt asked me to come to be the speaker at Voice of the Martyrs conference in Alexandria, Egypt. They said, listen, we don't want you flowing in the gifts of the Spirit. We've got Coptics, Methodists, Presbyterians. This is one big, you know, huge league, all these different folks, okay? I said, sure, I promise you I won't do nothing, not a syllable. Because the Lord, as soon as I heard them, there's times people I hear, people tell me, ask me to come to some place, and I know I'm not supposed to go. How do I know? There's no inspiration. It's a dud. Oh, we were just supposed to go because the door's open. Uh-uh. I need the gift of faith for anything I'm going to do. And the gift of faith is one gigantic tornado hurricane of inspiration. You just feel like I can pick the world up. I just grew as tall as this building. And there's nothing I can't do. Get out of my way. Anything that's in my way. That's what happens to you. Does it happen that way at the very first? No. You grow in it. Huh? You give yourself to obeying the Word of God. That's where faith gets activated, you know. Obedience. And I got there. They gave me a preacher. I don't remember if he was Methodist or Presbyterian, but I went to just talking about the kingdom of God. You can't talk about the kingdom of God not have the manifestation of the Holy Ghost. Cannot. Not the way I talk about the kingdom of God. And he froze. And praise God, he was not a Pentecostal because he's like, and everybody's standing there looking at him. I'm looking at him. And I'm acting like I don't even know. I'm like, what's wrong with you? I'm telling you, they ushered him to his seat. They brought up another guy. I'm not sure if he was the Presbyterian or the Methodist. I know I was dealing with those two, Presbyterian and Methodist. He comes up. He's going right along. He's translating for me. And he begins to get really slow. I'm going, come on, man, keep up. He looks at me. He goes, what are you doing to me? I said, I'm not doing anything to you, man. He said, no, I've never felt this way before. I don't. And he stuck, basically, with his mouth open. He sits down. I'm not doing anything. I look over at Nagy Atiya, who is one of the primary leaders in Voice of the Martyr, Randy White, who's a leader in Voice of the Martyr, not another Randy, Voice of the Martyr. I said, I haven't done nothing. Do you agree? I haven't done nothing. I'm being good, correct? They're all like. And the third guy, he went with it. He went with it. But I mean, just, it's nothing that we have to do. It's just the kingdom of God. We love the kingdom of God. I want the kingdom of God. I want the ministry of Jesus. I want to do what Jesus has purposed me to do. I don't want to misrepresent Him. I want to flow with Him. I don't want to preach another gospel. Paul said, if somebody comes preaching another gospel than the one that I preach, and I preach the one that Jesus preached, and when I preached the gospel, the fullness of the gospel, so that from Jerusalem to Illyricum, the gospel has fully been preached with mighty signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't want any other gospel. I don't want to be part of nothing else. See, that's a resolve. That's a resolve in my life. So that's the third part of it. It's this resolve. Number one, I believe that this is what Father wants me to have. He wants me to do this. I believe they're available. And I am resolved to have nothing other than these things. And I'm going to always be encouraged. The only one that's going to discourage me and tell me, ah, you the Son of God, if you got the gifts of the Spirit, turn these stones into bread. And we're just going to look back at him and say, no need. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. And then immediately, Satan takes him. Immediately, he gets translated. Satan takes him, translates him from the wilderness and puts him right up on the very top of the temple in Jerusalem. And says, if you're the Son of God, I want you to prove it. I'm not proving nothing. I won't. As soon as I feel anything, a proof coming on, any kind of competition thing, nope. I shut the thing down. I will not participate. I won't participate with strife. It is wrong. It is evil. I won't participate with jealousy, envy. I want to let it be in my spirit because it works counter to the flowing of the Holy Ghost. And I don't want no familiar spirit. I want His Spirit. Hallelujah. And there's spiritual laws to it. He said, cast yourself down. Throw yourself down. Everybody's going to know who you are because He's commanded His angels to take care of you, to hold you up with their hands so that you don't even stub your toe. And what is Jesus say, you should not tempt the Lord your God. You don't have to prove, you're not going. In other words, you don't have anything, you have no right to prove God, to analyze or evaluate God. Pretty radical, huh? Then he immediately translates him up into exceeding high mountain. That's so funny, you know, because theologians are trying to figure out what mountain that is in the geographical location. It's a mountain you can't see. Enoch, the book of Enoch isn't as weird as people think. There's mountains you can't see. There's deep valleys that you cannot observe. There's more going on than what meets your physical eye. There's angels all about us, a chariot of the Lord and the horsemen thereof. There's a geography that no one's even seen. Certain people who are able, whose eyes are open, whose eyes pop open, God will pop your eyes open if He wants to. He'll give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation if you're ready. And the more you receive, hallelujah, the more you're responsible to walk with Him. People walk around blind. Sin is darkness. People walk blind. To sin, you got to step over into darkness. You got to move out of the light. You got to step over in darkness and be blind. And people do that all the time. And as long as they're going to go, wait a minute, I just stepped over into darkness and I'm blind. And they go crying out to God, oh God, I don't want to do that. I don't want to be this way. I want to learn to walk in the ways of righteousness. Father's so good. He set it up through the blood of Jesus Christ that we can continue on and not ultimately end up in the same effect of Adam's once sin. Huh? He continues to forgive us so that many offenses, even with many offenses, there's still this mercy. There's still this righteousness. There's still this ability to move forward with God. But I'm going to tell you right now, God is going to have a new heaven and a new earth. I'm going to close with this. It's important for me to say this. God's going to have a new heaven and a new earth wherein there is no sin, where there will be no sin. Father is going to purge the universe of sin and iniquity, for what Satan did will never be reproduced. Don't you tell me that you're not going to have to deal with pride and arrogancy and lies and all the rest of the deceit and get it shut down before you leave this realm. Because I'm going to tell you right now, Jesus is serious about it. He's serious about it. He said, your eye offends you? And he says, does your eye, literally, is scandalon, is the Greek word for it, scandalon, is to create the scandal. Has your eye created a scandal? It's primarily translated stumbling block. Has your eye created for you a stumbling block? It was all in the it's all in the context. If you look on a woman to lust after, you've already committed the sin of adultery. Pop it out. For it is profitable for you, Jesus said, that your one member perish and that you be the one-eyed Jack in heaven. Are you with me? That you have one eye. Then to be cast into the fires of hell, having your whole body intact. That's what he said. He said, your foot, your hand. Oh, come on. He's serious about this. We need to get serious about it. We need to get serious about the lost. We need to be serious first and foremost about our relationship with him and what he wants. We need to be serious about his aim and his purpose in that context. First and foremost, it's a relationship. Father, the relationship. I see people run around, the whole context of their walk with God is about their ministry. And they don't really have a viable relationship, really. God wants the relationship. That's first and foremost. And in that viability of that relationship, the beauty of that relationship, then our heart's fixed on what his heart's fixed on. And because we don't want to, Jesus didn't want to see people left in sickness and disease. Huh? He ain't come promote religion. He came get people out of their trap. He came and said, I set you free from your prison. He didn't ask people, do you want to be set free from your prison? He says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he's anointed me. This is great Holy Ghost signs and wonders. He's anointed me to proclaim liberty to the captives. Huh? He's anointed me to preach this good news to the poor, to bind up the broken in heart, to fix them right there on the spot, to proclaim liberty to the captives, to open up the prison doors to them that are bound. Jesus didn't tell Paul to do something very, very similar. He said, I'm give you the power to go turn them from darkness to light. Now, don't ask them, would you like to be turned from darkness to light? I'm going to create an atmosphere for you. I'm turning you. You've been in darkness. You've been blinded by the mind-blinding spirits. I'm setting you free right now. You're going to see and know and understand that God exists and that he loves you. To turn them from the power of Satan to the power of God. That is radical. Do you understand that authority that you have? Hallelujah. This is following Jesus. To open up the eyes of the blind. Hallelujah. To live in this realm. I started ministering this on Wednesday night. You can't abdicate your authority and walk in authority. And the Lord makes a contrast in Romans 6:16. He says either you're going to walk in obedience as the slaves of the Lord, or you're going to walk in sin as the slaves of Satan or the slaves of death. And whatever to whomever you are subject, you can't serve two masters. I bring what Jesus said concerning mammon, because the same thing applies. You can't serve two masters. Okay? We've actually received a transition from the master of sin and death over to the master, hallelujah, of life and the spirit. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus is our master, our ruler. The Holy Ghost is our master and ruler. Now, let's walk with our master and ruler. What is he going to do? He's going to teach us to do what he does. Hallelujah. Aha. If we want to learn his disposition, his way of living, then he's going to fill us with the compassion when we see someone in a wheelchair, we can't walk by them. We've got to get them out of the wheelchair. Now, here's one of the things that I want to be able to do, and I'm believing God for. I walk down the streets of Nepal because, see, there's an anointing in the Holy Ghost. There's a corporate anointing that I've begun to learn how to function in. And we saw that in the crusades that we've done. But I've walked down the streets of Nepal, and I've seen people on the little blocks with no legs. Huh? I've seen people with no legs, no arms. And I was filled with more fear than I was compassion. Huh? I want to be able to move in a relationship and a yieldedness to the Holy Spirit that I'm overwhelmed with the same kind of faith and boldness of those areas that I'm already now familiar with, flow in successfully. I know the transition. I want you to understand the transition. Two hands for beginners. Hello. You ain't going to force God to do nothing. You ain't going to tell God, get here and do such and such. He's going to tell you, get over here and do such and such. Hallelujah. You can hold your Bible up all you want and say, God, you said in your word. He knows what he said in his word. And he's moving in faith, man. And we want, this is the dynamic of a relationship, the dynamics of inspiration. Hallelujah. This is the good life. Come on, I say ya. It'll come to a place, you just start asking God, for example, for souls. That is a miracle to get souls. You start asking God for souls, and you'll discover that you won't be as afraid. Sometimes people, when they go to witness or talk to people about their soul, they're more afraid than they have compassion. All right, you understand? They're more fearful and intimidated. And what do I say? That's not inspiration. Walk around in a circle and pray till you get something, man. I mean, just whatever it takes. Just the activity of doing it, stepping out there, saying, Lord, just give me one word. Just asking to give you one word. One day I got finished preaching, and the Lord was just, he was developing me. And so I'm going to tell you right now, a great thing happened in my life right after this. I'm not going to talk about it right now. But I'm finished preaching. It's on a Sunday morning. And we were having church right across the street from the sports arena where they had the big market every weekend. And the Lord said, I want you to go across the street. The Lord's made it very clear to me. I want you to go across the street and proclaim that which I put in your mouth. I knew I would, I'd just been flowing in the Holy Ghost, just preached, just prayed for everybody in the place. So we finished up church service. Mom went, took care of the kids. I walked across the street. And when I'm walking across the street, I'm knowing I'm getting a download of what I'm supposed to do. There's this big light pole, and the light pole's all over the place, and they have like concrete that comes up to about right here. Okay, so I'm seeing myself standing on that concrete, holding onto the pole, because now I'm at least 3 foot above everybody. And so I still don't know what I'm supposed to say. I crawl up onto the concrete. I mean, there's just a stream of folks, right? It's like I'm being tested, I'm telling you. There's a stream of folks. I get up onto the concrete. I'm hanging off of the pole, and I'm saying this. Immediately, since I got up there, the Lord filled my mouth with his word. Anybody who wants Jesus, come to me. Anybody who wants to know the living God, come to me. If you want to know who Jesus is, come to me right now. That's all I'm saying over and again. If you want to know who Jesus is, I know that the power of proof is present with me. No one came. People would walk by me and say, oh, you're insulting the whole Christian movement. You are a reproach up there. Do you have any idea of what you look like? I'm getting all these kind of great compliments. And I kept with it until the Lord released me. And then I went back, and some great things I'm telling you, it's inside of 30 days. Some great things, just floodgates opened up in ministry opportunities. We did something within 30 days. We started doing something that went all over the world, and it was called Sunriders, and it featured all the top surfers. And actually, Nikki's a fruit of that. She came to Jesus through that. It went all over the world. I mean, people would be out on Westpac and say, wow, I just saw that in the Philippines. It went all over the world. Sometimes the Lord asks us to do things of the dynamics we don't understand, but the obedience breaks open opportunities for us. I mean, I found a long time ago that when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, when you're cursed and you bless, curse not, that the grace of God will abide upon you. We just got to be willing. But let's do it under inspiration. Let's go ahead and believe God for divine inspiration. Let's believe God that when the Holy Ghost moves, he moves upon us, just like we read in the Scripture. They all began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Jesus said, you cannot be my witnesses without this kind of inspiration, without this kind of empowerment without this kind of direct impact by the Holy Ghost. We're going to have to resign ourselves to that. Otherwise, we're going to get off on religious tracks out of human effort, and it's not going to be, it's by my spirit, saith the Lord. It's going to be by might and power. It's going to be by human ability. It's going to be sheer determination because you feel you got to get this thing done. No. If there's anybody that could have been a witness of Jesus' resurrection, it had been Peter, James, and John. He said, no, you can't be a witness. They saw with his eyes. They handled him. Even Thomas stuck his hand into the side of the Lord Jesus and thrust his finger through the hole in his hand. He said, you can't be my witness. You can't till you go get endued with power from on high. Because there's an inspiration there. It's where now the Holy Ghost gives us speech. He gives us utterance. We get to speak expressly by the Spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. He takes all the fear away. He fills us with confidence and boldness. He fills us with compassion. There's got to be a beginning. There's got to be a want to. There's got to be a willingness. Once again, dear people, it starts right there in the relationship, down on your knees, there in the relationship, walking around in your interaction with the Lord. And then you give yourself in the things that the Lord, opportunities that the Lord opens for you in ministry. That's not accidental. You got an opportunity. Well, I don't think I'm getting to advance quite as quickly as I should. We need to make a special school for you. It's going to be called the School of Elisha. How to purposefully wash the hands of the man of God for an undefined period of time. And we'll bring you into the room and we'll just talk to you about that over and again. When you're feeling bad, somebody said to me, I gave up everything to be here. Oh, well, that's very good. Like I'm supposed to give you a reward or say something about that, because it's not me. It's you. It's what you're doing with the Lord. Huh? Elisha gave up everything to be here, to wash the hands. He didn't get to prophesy. He got berated. What do you want from me? Says Elijah. But look at the boldness. Look at the I want double what you got. Come on, man. Look, I've done giving everything. I want double what you got. You ask a hard thing. Because any man can give, any man potentially in the realms of the spiritual laws can give what he has. Huh? No man can give anything that he hasn't first received. Now, Elisha says, I want double what you got. I want something that's going to be more than you supply to me. Hallelujah. You better be faithful in the things that God's given you to do in the school of the Spirit. Flowing in the gifts of the Spirit is easy as breathing. When you begin to find the beauty of it, the comfort of it, the flow of it, hallelujah. Elizabeth walks into a village in Africa, and there was a woman sitting by the door in the village, and the inspiration came over her. It wasn't her first, you know, outing out in the Holy Ghost, though, right? She'd been in this. She says to the woman, she said, how long have you sat here? The woman sat there many years. Remember how many years it was. She said, what do you want? What would you want above anything else in your life? If you could have anything, what would you want? And the woman said, so that I could go out and work in the fields with the rest of the people. Elizabeth said, get up. They reached out and took a hold of her hand. The woman got up. Listen, there's a realm of inspiration. There's a realm of just, this is what we're supposed to be doing. You've got to know what you're supposed to be doing for the inspiration to ever work. I'm going to say it one more time in closing. First of all, if you want to function, flow, and operate in the gifts of the Spirit, number one, you got to know that God has purpose and wants you to do this. This is what He wants. This is His will. His manifest will by voluminous repetition. And by example of everyone who followed him. Two, that it's available for you. God's no respecter of persons. What he's done for one, he will do for you. The manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to everyone. Hallelujah. When you got baptized in the Holy Ghost, you got a powerful proof that God wanted you to do these works and greater works. The church functioned in such a way that these signs follow them that believe. Everybody is doing it. Amen. In my name you cast out devils. Orabasta, to speak it et paranoste with new tongues that have never been heard before. Hallelujah. This is the way of the Lord. And then thirdly, you want it more than anything else. I don't care what it takes. I don't care what it costs me. I want this more than anything else. Amen. And then the Lord just makes it all happen. And one day you find yourself standing on a platform doing a mass evangelism crusade. Somebody says mass evangelism crusade is essential. Absolutely. There's too many people to reach to get to them without it. There's approximately 3 billion people that have never heard the gospel. The unreached people groups. They've never heard the gospel. And then if you want to talk about how many people have never heard the gospel or has never been presented like Jesus presented it, he said, this gospel of the kingdom, it may be 90%. I don't know. So no matter what, with all the very, it takes everything. It takes everything. It's going off the beaten path to the remote villages like Phil does. That's reaching unreached people groups that are just on the side of the road that have been looked over and passed over, to going to actually the nations that have never had the gospel preached to them because they've been closed off, shut off. You know, Burma, Myanmar is having all kinds of trouble right now. A new uprising has begun. A new revolution has begun. Praise God, Tim got to go in there with two great crusades, mass evangelism crusades, with more than 30,000 people in a night, and they got to see all kinds of miracles. They live in with miracles. I had a guy run me down in the airport one day in Nepal. I was in the backwoods of Nepal because, their little airplane hoppers just go all over the place. They got all these little teeny airports because these airplanes don't go very far. But at any rate, I have this guy run me down in the airport. Pastor Mark, Pastor Mark, Pastor Mark. I turn around and I'm looking at somebody I've never seen before. He said, I still want to talk to you. I'm a pastor of a church up here and da-da-da-da in the hills of the Himalayas. And he said, we have a sermon every day, every Sunday in our church service that took place, that is a sermon that is a result of the crusade. I said, well, what is it? He said, well, we took a Hindu man, an Orthodox Hindu. Orthodox Hindus are more than, fundamentalist extremists. These are the extremists. This is an Orthodox Hindu. We took an Orthodox Hindu who had been crippled for the majority of his life to the crusade, and he walked in the crusade. All he does on Sunday morning is stand up and look around, and the whole place just goes completely ballistic. He's a living sermon. He just moves around a little bit. This is all you got to do. How many living sermons right now are in Burma, Myanmar, because Tim went? Praise God. How many of you will go? Ann and I were standing on a platform with a friend of ours doing a crusade that touched the whole nation. Helicopters going off, completely shuts down the city because the traffic coming into the crusade was so huge. President on the platform of the nation. And Ann just standing there, just weeping, saying, this is what we will do. This is what God wants us to do. The Lord will hit you with it. I don't care who you are. It does not matter. It doesn't matter if you're a little child, if you're a timid woman, or if you're a great, big, strong man. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. It's irrelevant. The fact of it is, God is able to use people who can't do it. Because those who can't do it come into a knee-knocking, trembling reliance upon the Holy Ghost. My friend John, who has been having such amazing miracles and signs and wonders. The guy told you, prayed for the deaf girl for, almost an hour before her ears popped open. He's so overwhelmed by his sense of dependency upon the Lord. You talk about trembling before the Lord. He can't really sleep. He just lays in bed praying, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God. That's just who he is. That's where he's at with God. But the signs and the wonders and the miracles. He came to me one day, he said to me, he said, I can't ever be like you. I said, good. He said, I can never know the Bible like you know the Bible. You don't have to. I'm never going to be able to preach like you preach. You don't need to. Just say what God puts in your mouth. I'm not really that educated. I don't really know that many things. I'm a dirt man. I do dirt. I can push dirt around. No, no, no. He put his word in your mouth and speak it boldly. All you got to do is get comfortable with that. This is what Father wants for you. That's available to you. Now want it more than anything else. Now want it more than anything else. Now want it more than, now want it more than, now you got it. I'm going to get that no matter what it takes. I'm having that. Amen. Praise the Lord. But I've failed so many times. I've made so many mistakes. Doesn't disqualify you. Doesn't disqualify you. What qualifies you is that you want to get it right. What qualifies you is that when you read, listen to me, Matthew 5:48, and you hear Jesus say, be perfect. Even as your Father in heaven is perfect, your heart goes, yes, I want that. That qualifies you. You're not trying to disqualify God's word. It's alive to you. You're not looking to yourself to do it. Because that's a great test. That's a great acid test, litmus test, better word. Because if you think, if all of a sudden you start saying, I can't do that, if that's impossible, how can it, how could the Lord Jesus, must be some other, you know, way to translate this. There's not. One of the things I'm doing in my translation of the Bible is I'm taking what's only been available to scholars who read Greek and Hebrew that shows every variant and every text that exists on the planet that you have to understand. Yeah, once again, you have to read in Greek or Hebrew because even footnotes is in Greek and Hebrew. And I'm making it available in the side notes so people can see. This is your own maximal degree of latitude here. When it comes to verse 48, Matthew chapter 5, all texts agree. There's no variation. And all, of course, these variations that we do talk about exist within the 5,600 MSS or manuscripts that exist that are what we call extant manuscripts. There are just minor differences anyways. No, it just, it is what it says, what it, God says what it, he means. And he watches over his word to perform it. And all we got to do is say, look, I want to do it this way. I want to do it with you. And you, look, he said, surely as I live, this whole earth will be filled with my glory. He said it, right? Numbers 14. He said it in the context of being rejected by his people. And now what he's done is he's produced within inside of you and me rivers of his glory so that the whole earth would be filled with it. And we cannot find ourselves retreating to our own human ability, but with total abandonment say, God, live through me. God, manifest yourself through me. God, do through me that which is impossible. That which is impossible. I don't carry that banner, really, believing for the impossible. But what happened was leaders, actually it was the Alliance, the Federation of Churches, rather, the Alliance Federation of Churches in Nepal, 2008 Crusade. They said, we really need a banner theme. They called me up so for the marketing campaign. I said, well, I don't have anything. So let me pray about it. And then the Lord spoke to me, believing for the impossible. And so we gave that. And of course, that's now Evangelist John's banner. You know, we just handed that over to him, let him run with it. But that's it. This is who we are. We believe for the impossible. We just live this way. And you get to live this way every day. You don't have to be in a crusade to see that grow and increase in your life. And nothing's going to grow and increase in your life that you're not engaged in. Because you've got a lot of needs. You've got a lot of things. You've got a lot of dreams. You've got a lot of vision. You've got a lot of purpose. Father has poured out his Holy Ghost upon all flesh so that you can prophesy. Hallelujah. And he says, covet. Covet, prophesy. Hallelujah. And we're going to train you how to do it right. Amen. Amen. We're going to train you how to do it in praise. We're going to train you how to do it in prayer. We're going to train you how to do it where you don't get all self-conscious and feel like, oh my goodness, you under the gun, get all nervous. Because you know what? As William Branham said, I got to relax my brain first. Give me a few minutes here, will you, brethren? Give me a few minutes to relax my brain. It's a powerful statement. If you watch all the William Branham tapes, you're going to hear him say that at least three times. If you watch all the William Branham, well, I need to relax my brain. And he relaxes that brain at the word of knowledge starts. Well, your name is Eva York, and you live right here in this city, and you live at 163 S Street. Go home and be healed and praise God as you go. Amen. And, oh, the cancer, the whole gorder is cancer. It's gone. Ah! Because he relaxed, he knew how to relax his brain, as he put it. And it's so much. It just gets getting out of our stuff. We walk around with all of our stuff, all of our concepts and doctrines and ideas and measure of God. And all we know and understand theologically. Stuck in a rut, trapped like ratchets. No more in Jesus' name. How it is simple to the Lord make it. He breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Ghost. It's as easy as breathing. This is a new kind of life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Many, I'm going to say this, and then we're going to close. This is my fifth closing. But many of the unbeliever have their brain more relaxed than many of God's believers. I mean, I was performing my son's wedding, Joshua and Ellie standing there, I just breathed on them. I went, and one of Ellie's lost cousins said, I got hit with that when you breathed out. That is powerful. How do you do that? And everybody, you know, and then many Christians are like, oh, why is he breathing? See, they need to relax their mind. Hopefully I've made the point of what that means. Amen. You know, I used to pray and say, Lord, I want to understand diversity of tongues, because every tongue that ever came out of my mouth, it didn't sound like the same thing. And one day I woke up and was coming out. It was different. Started coming out, it was different. Which creates an atmosphere. And it was different. And then there was about for miracles. There was for gifts of healing. Different atmospheres would be created by the language. There was all of a sudden I began to recognize a tongue. I can't do it. I could be in a place to do it before the Lord. But there was a tongue associated with gifts of healing. I knew gifts of healing. Before I knew the atmosphere of gifts of healing, I recognized it by the tongue. Ha ha. That's not it, but I'm still flowing there. Hallelujah. And it is a gujimane. Is a foundation. It's a doorway in. It's an entrance gift into an unlimited realm. So we can learn how to move here. We can learn how to recognize that. We can learn how to recognize the gift of faith. Go, that's the gift of faith right there. Wow, that's the gift. There's a miracle working right there. And it's real. It's not imaginary. It's real. Amen. It's a perception that is developed in our lives by the Holy Ghost. It's a beautiful thing. Oh, just covet it. Just want it. Just desire it. Don't feel like left out. If you feel left out, alienated, you got relationship problems. There's no left out. There's no left behind. There's no alienated. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Well, is there anybody want to ask any questions, anything, that any issues, any needs right now, any pain, sickness, disease, any problems? Should come to the School of the Spirit on the night that we're talking about gifts of the Spirit, and not walk away with what you need. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody says, can you function all 9 gifts of the Spirit? Yes, every service. You may. If you need to. If all you need to do is prophesy, then that's what's going to happen. But if you're wide open and you're just like, oh, God, use me, take hold of me, use me, the Lord put it on you, go pray for somebody who needs a miracle. Go jerk somebody out of a wheelchair. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Well, amen. Everybody, let me tell you something to do. Cooperate with love. Spend a whole bunch of time with love. So instead, I need to love more. Okay, well, then hug people more. Then just do that. Just love them. And when you're in challenging situations where, you know, people are doing something other than giving you the kind of love that you want, that's your opportunity to grab a hold of the Holy Ghost and say, Holy Spirit, love through me. Love through me. Sipodanaya. Say, love through me. Sipodanaya. Say, love through me. So remind me. Say, oh, God, I'm so desperate about the world seeing your love. Love through me. Let your love be manifested in my life. That's your love. Receive it. I want you to walk out of here so full of love tonight. I want you to see how real it is. I want you to see how real it is when you ask God, that you just ask God for love and he gives it to you. That's his saponamayatai. It's a miracle tongue. Pataneya. Ha. Saponaneya. Patonane. Rupatoya. Segadina. Segadina, my. Hallelujah. And I'm going to tell you, as God fills you with love, like this, self-consciousness goes away. You could have had, you could have had garlic pie before you came to the meeting, and you just wouldn't be even caring at all. Hallelujah. And then the people around you that are filled with the love of God, they wouldn't care either. Satana moya. Hallelujah. Poranaya kishi. Totapananaya. Receive right now this love from heaven. And live in it. Walk in it. And build yourself up in your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Keep yourself in the love of God. Hallelujah. Poranaya sete to labo. Nangjelo. And then you're always available to preach in season and out of season at any instant. That's what that means. At any moment, you're ready. Hallelujah. You're ready for the inspirations of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Kanaseya te. Kanaseya te apa. Hallelujah. Say kanaseya te apa. Say kanaseya te apa. Hallelujah. Say kanaseya te apa. Say it. Say kanaseya te apa. That ain't that hard, is it? Kanaseya te apa. Say it, Poranai. Say Poranai. Poranai. Poranai, I see. Edimanakea. Hallelujah. Poranaste. Berenendibela. Halamangesto. Halamangesto. Now, you'd be surprised to recognize or realize that some of God's greatest generals and champions in the faith who flowed and functioned signs and wonders took tongues, put them on tapes from people who had anointings and just did nothing but rehearse it and through that step into an anointing. Oh, yeah. There's more going on than what you realize. You want to be taught. You want to come into the school. Say, I want to come into the school. I want to learn from everybody else who's functioned and operated in the anointing. If you're going to grow it, if you're going to grow a business to $40 million, you should not be interested in the person who's got a bunch of ideas about how to do it. You should listen to the person who grew a company to $40 million because they can tell you what to do. Huh? That's just in the natural. The Holy Spirit has come. He's the one who knows how to do these things. We want to listen to him. We want to receive his instruction. Hallelujah. It may be foolishness to the thinking realm, but it's the power of God. Amen. At work. So find a bunch of people around you now. Hallelujah. And hug them. And don't stay in little groups. And don't run for the exit. Oh, I'm scared.